The Blake class was a two-ship set of protected cruisers built for the Royal Navy at the end of the 19th century. Whilst the divide of roles at the time called for the armoured cruiser to take the role of fleet unit and the protected cruiser to be largely a commerce and colonial protection unit, with some limited utility in the anti-torpedo boat and scouting roles with the fleet, the Royal Navy actually ended up dividing their cruisers into 1st, 2nd and 3rd class units. The 3rd class were small protected cruisers intended solely for commerce and colonial work, often the gunboat diplomacy role. The 2nd class were larger protected cruisers that would have a role with the fleet as described previously. The 1st class were, up until this point, the armoured cruisers. To give some idea of relative armaments and size, with a few exceptions, 3rd class cruisers of the period generally carried half a dozen or more 4.7-inch guns and averaged between 1,500 and 1,800 tons displacement in the Royal Navy. 2nd class cruisers carried either 6-inch guns or a mix of 4.7 and 6-inch guns and averaged 2,500 to 4,000 tons. The 1st class cruisers were 5,500 to 8,500 tons and carried a mixture of 6-inch and 9.2-inch guns. Enter the highly skilled and highly prolific designer William White, recently appointed Director of Naval Construction. He wanted to combine the trade protection and fleet roles fully. Whereas fleet units needed speed and could afford to sacrifice range to a certain extent, and commerce and colonial units needed range above all, but often sacrificed speed as a result, he sought to build a first-class protected cruiser that possessed both high speed and long range. Bearing in mind the figures that we gave just a minute ago, a few eyes rather widened at the design of the Blakes. At just over 9,000 tons displacement, they were huge for the time, with a power plant of vertical triple expansion engines driving two shafts with 13,000 indicated horsepower for a speed of 20 knots at natural draft. But they were designed to be able to take a forced draft that upped the power to 20,000 indicated horsepower and the speed rose to 22 knots. Whilst this might not sound especially fast, this was still between 5 and 8 knots faster than most contemporary battleships, and thus is the equivalent of a 30-knot cruiser in World War I or a 33 to 35-knot cruiser in World War II. Forced draft was a technique that exploited the fact that air only had so many places to leave the engineering spaces, and used a fan or fans, depending on the ship design, to force more air through the intakes, thus raising the overall air pressure within the engineering spaces, and thus increasing the density of oxygen, which increased the burn rate of the fuel and the temperature of the fire. This worked on the same principle as the bellows or pumps that you might find in a forge. The advantage, of course, was more power from your engines. The disadvantage was that the machinery generally wasn't designed to operate at that kind of temperature for very long, and so forced draft was used only sparingly. The main armament on the ships was likewise impressive. Gone were the lighter weapons that characterised the 2nd class protected cruiser up to this point. Instead, a pair of single 9.2-inch guns were mounted, one fore and one aft, together with 10 6-inch guns, half a dozen in open mounts and four in casemates, one deck lower. In battle, this was intended as a combined primary armament, the higher rate of fire of the 6-inch guns supplementing the slower firing but far more powerful 9.2-inch weapons in a format that was more commonly seen on armoured cruisers. Originally, this was supposed to have been 8 older 6-inch guns on the same deck, but after trials against an old ironclad, the larger battery of new quick-firing 6-inch guns was selected to complement the two larger weapons. A secondary battery of 16 47mm guns for anti-torpedo boat work and the like was also installed, along with four small-calibre torpedo tubes, with two single tubes below the waterline and two single tubes above the waterline. The armour deck that provided the ship's vitals with protection arced over the engines and magazines with a 3-inch thick flat top section and the sloped sides being 6 inches thick. The casemates, 9.2-inch guns, and conning tower were also protected by various thicknesses of armour, which hit 12 inches on the conning tower. However, it should be borne in mind that this was not Krupp steel or even Harvey steel, so the protective value of this armour was not as great as might be suggested by the pure thickness values if you're used to the average armour values of World War I and World War II era ships. During fleet exercises, shortly after commissioning, HMS Blenheim, the second of the class, proved to be very capable in the role that she had been designed for, being employed by her team as a heavy scout, using her superior speed and great firepower to catch, drive off, and where possible, destroy numerous opposing second and third class cruisers as well as torpedo boats. As the two exercise teams closed in, she then led a contingent of smaller Apollo-class cruisers to ensure that her team could break through the opposing fleet screen. In many ways, these activities foreshadowed the development of the battle cruiser just over a decade in the future, and indeed this term, hyphenated, was used in literature to describe her at the time. So successful were these ships that, despite a number of early mechanical troubles, they almost put an end to the armoured cruiser in Royal Navy service, with the next three classes of first-class cruiser continuing the pattern laid down by the Blakes, at varying sizes. The armoured cruiser would only reappear almost a decade later with the construction of the Cressy class at the turn of the century. Although commissioned in the early part of the 1890s, and thus only about 20 years old by the time World War I broke out, the two ships, HMS Blake and HMS Blenheim, were entirely obsolete by the time this conflict rolled around. Thus, they entered the conflict as depot ships, albeit that the demands of war saw HMS Blenheim end up supporting the Gallipoli landings, a task which many of the Royal Navy's older vessels found themselves carrying out, whilst Blake saw out the war as depot ship to the 11th Destroyer Flotilla. Blenheim had also had a bit of a side career going as a mobile morgue for VIPs, transporting no less than three dead important individuals back to their home countries after they'd had the temerity to die overseas in the course of their careers. With the rise of the treaty-era cruiser, both ships were disposed of in the 1920s. Blake in 1922, and Blenheim a few years later.
That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you have a comment or suggestion for a ship to review, let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to comment on the pinned post for dry dock questions.